In this video, we'll study about some basic type of neocortex. The neocortex are five fundamental types. They are agranular, frontal, parietal, granular and polar. Among this, the agranular and the granular are heterotypical. The other three are homotypical. Now we'll see about the agranular type. The agranular type, the pyramidal neurons of various size are predominant in most of the layers of the cortex, although you have scattered number of stellate neurons. The agranular cortex is present in the motor and the premotor area, the area number 4, 6, 8 and 44, and in some parts of limbic system. Since the pyramidal cells gives rise to the efferent projection fibers, the agranular cortex is concerned with basic motor function. The next type we will see is the granular cortex or coneocortex. So this cortex presents closely packed stellate neurons in most of the laminae and displays the medium and the large pyramidal cells, leaving only a few scattered population of small pyramidal neurons. The granular cortex is seen in the postcentral gyrus. So this is a postcentral gyrus. So it is seen in the postcentral gyrus and in the striate area, area number 17. Then in the anterior transverse temporal gyrus, the area number 41 and 42, and in some parts of the parahippocampal gyrus. The granular cortex is the thinnest of the five fundamental types, and the granular cortex receives specific afferent projection fibers and it is concerned with the conscious integration of sensory function. In addition to this, you have small pyramidal cells of granular cortex which gives rise to efferent projection fibers. Now we'll see about the frontal type. The frontal type shows abundance of small and medium sized pyramidal neurons and less number of stellate neurons. This type is available in the prefrontal cortex, and then it is also available in some parts of the parietal and temporal lobes. Next we'll see about the parietal type. The parietal type shows the stellate neurons which are more prominent than the pyramidal cells. The pyramidal cells here are small size. This type of cortex is found most of the parietal and the temporal lobes and also some part of frontal lobe. The next type is the polar cortex. As the name indicates, it is found mostly in the frontal and the occipital poles. Now we'll see about the functional areas of the cerebral cortex. For functional analysis, different neurobiologists divide the cortex into a number of areas. As for example, by Campbell, he divided the brain into 20 areas, and Broadman into 52 areas, and Economo into 109 areas, and Walk into 200 areas. At present, the Broadman's area are frequently used as a ready reference for functions. Broadly speaking, the cortical area is subdivided into motor, sensory and psychical areas. Now we'll see about the motor areas. The motor area are further subdivided into primary motor area, premotor area, supplementary motor area and prefrontal area. First we'll see about the primary motor area, the area number 4. So this is the primary motor area, the area number 4. So this includes the precentral gyrus. So this is the central sulcus. In front of the central sulcus, you have the precentral gyrus. So this forms the primary motor area, and also it extends on the medial surface of the cerebrum into the anterior part of the paracentral lobule. So this is the whole thing is the paracentral lobule. The anterior part of the paracentral lobule also included into the motor area. Structurally, the area 4 belongs to agranular cortex, where you have giant pyramidal cells of beds, each having the diameter of 15 to 60 micrometer and the heights of 30 to 120 micrometer, and with a total number not exceeding 35,000. These are confined in the posterior part of the area 4 along the central sulcus and more numerous in the paracentral lobule. Now we'll see the afferents to area number 4. The area number 4 along with the area number 6 are connected to the afferent projection fibers. So these afferent projection fibers arises from the anterior and intermediate nucleus of thalamus. So from there the afferent projection fibers arises and they terminate into the area number 4. Thus the motor cortex is influenced by the ipsilateral corpus striatum and contralateral cerebellar hemisphere. Next, the area number 4 is connected by association fibers with the postcentral gyrus. So association fibers with the postcentral gyrus and other cortical areas of the same hemisphere, and by the commissural fibers of the corpus callosum with the opposite side hemisphere. Next we'll see about the efferent fibers. The area number 4 along with area number 6, 3, 1, 2, 5 and 7, they provide the principal origin of corticobulbar, corticonuclear and corticospinal tract. The motor area and the premotor area, they give rise to the frontopontine fibers. So they terminate into the contralateral cerebellar hemisphere through the nuclei pontus. So this furnish the program of motor function. Apart from this, the area number 4 gives rise to efferent fibers to the corpus striatum, the red nucleus and the brainstem reticular nucleus. So these influence the activities of the subcortical extrapyramidal centers. Next we'll see the functions of the primary motor area. The primary motor cortex controls the movements of the voluntary muscle of the contralateral side of the body. The centers for the movements are represented somatotopically in an inverted position with the head end below and the leg up, and this is known as the motor homunculus. The extent of the cortical area depends upon the skill of the movement and not on the size of the muscle. So here you can see the representation for the face and the fingers of the hand is more extensive. The center for the movement from below upward on the lateral surface are as follows. From below you have the lips, the tongue, the larynx, the pharynx, the face, the head and neck, the upper extremity with an extensive area for the fingers of the hand, the trunk and the lower extremity above the knee joint. The lower extremity below the knee and the volitional control of the micturition and defecation are located on the medial surface in the anterior part of the paracentral lobule. The precentral gyrus is concerned with the movements and not for individual muscles. When you stimulate the motor area artificially, you may feel the tingling sensation and numbness on the contralateral side of the body. Therefore, these areas are primarily motor and secondarily sensory in function. Hence, these areas are designated as M(s)1. When you see the effects of lesion, the ablation of the primary motor cortex results in flaccid paresis of contralateral movement with decreased deep tendon reflexes and positive Babinski sign. So this is followed by moderate recovery of the function except the retention of the positive Babinski sign and decreased ability to perform skillful movements. Now we'll see the premotor area, the area number 6 and area number 8. The area number 6 lies in front of area number 4 and includes the posterior part of the superior, middle and the inferior frontal gyri. It extends onto the medial surface of the frontal lobe and it is continuous with the sublimentary motor area. The area number 8 lies in front of area number 6 and this involves the posterior part of the middle frontal gyrus. Structurally, both area number 6 and 8 belong to agranular cortex and are motor in function. Connections of the premotor area are almost similar to the primary motor area and they provide the origin of the corticobulbar, corticonuclear and corticospinal fibers. Some authors consider that the premotor area acts as a cortical center for extrapyramidal system. When you see the functions, the area number 6 integrates the series of voluntary movements to perform skillful act. The upper part of the area number 6 is believed to possess a writing center which is concerned with the coordinated movements of writing. In the dominant hemisphere, usually the left hemisphere, the lower part of the 6 extends forward into the inferior frontal gyrus and this rostral extension is known as the Broca's area, the area number 44 and 45, which acts as a motor speech center and regulates the coordinated movement of the lips, tongue, palate, larynx and pharynx. In short, the premotor area is concerned with the programming of the movements which are executed by the area 4 after the messages are corrected by the corpus striatum, cerebellum and thalamus. The area number 8 is also known as the frontal eye field and regulates the voluntary conjugate movements of the eye. The stimulation of this area produces the conjugate deviation of the eyes to the opposite side. Next, we'll see about the sublimentary motor area. It is located on the medial surface of the hemisphere in the posterior part of the medial frontal gyrus. So, this is a medial frontal gyrus. The posterior part forms the sublimentary motor area. This is a continuation of the area number 6. The sublimentary motor area receives afferents from the inner segment of the globus pallidus. So these fibers goes to the ventroanterior or ventrolateral nuclei of thalamus. From there it goes to the sublimentary motor area. The efferent fibers mainly connect to the ipsilateral primary motor cortex, the area number 4, and also a substantial contribution to the corticospinal tract. The body is represented in the sublimentary motor area as follows: the face in the anterior part, the leg posterior, and the upper limb, upper extremity in between. When you see the function of the sublimentary motor area, it is to control the complex movement which requires a sequential organization. So it elicits the sensation of an urge to movement. Damage to this area produces akinesia, and posterior part of the area receives some modality on non-specific sensation, since the sublimentary motor area is more motor than sensory. It is designated as MS2. Symptoms of upper motor neuron paralysis with spasticity and exaggerated detendon reflexes result from the conjoint involvement of the primary motor area, the premotor area, and sublimentary motor area. Next, we'll see about the second motor area. So, this is the second motor area, which lies in association with secondary somatic sensory area in the superior lip of the posterior ramus of the lateral sulcus, just below the area number 4, 3, 1 and 2. So, this is the second motor area. Next, we'll see about the prefrontal area. The prefrontal area, area number 9 to 12, the rest of the frontal lobe, rostral to the premotor cortex, which is subdivided by Brodmann's into 9 to 12 areas, and area 12 may predominantly in the orbital surface. So, these are the prefrontal area. When you see the connections, the prefrontal area is connected with the dorsomedial nucleus of the thalamus, hypothalamus and limbic system. It also receives long association fibers from almost all areas of the cerebral cortex. When you see the function of the prefrontal area, the dorsolateral part of the prefrontal cortex of both hemispheres are actively involved during waking us in supervisory attentional system, and these are essential for conscious learning of all kinds. It operates as working memory, which is held in mind to perform a known task. This prefrontal area is essential for abstract thinking, mature judgment, foresight, and tactfulness. One can distinguish between right and wrong, pleasure and displeasure with an intact prefrontal cortex. Since the function of this area is non-specific, it forms the so-called silent area of the brain. And this prefrontal area is highly developed in the human brain. Some authors suggest that the prefrontal area represents the neocortical control center of the limbic system. When you see the effects of lesion, the patients with the tumor of frontal lobe or with the atrophy of the prefrontal cortex exhibit symptoms which are mostly mental, with a lack of sense of responsibility in personal affairs, vulgarity in speech, clownish in behavior, and feelings of euphoria.